when we get to Calais, people, that is when the madness begins. That is when we let rip. That is when we let ourselves spurt. Down to the south of F.
Four motorcycles. Four men. Four play. Their mission? To find the baddest, raddest motorcycle on the face of the planet. Or maybe even off the edge of it. Fast Bike magazine. Believe it scares us as much as it scares you. First thing you gotta do with the allegedly four most powerful motorcycles in the Milky Way is to prove it. Of course, the first thing you discover is that the first bike isn't actually as powerful as its predecessor. That's right. For the second time of asking, Yamaha's fabled R1 turfed out less actual horsepower than the Thunder Ace. 136 rear-wheel horses. This we kind of expected, but what we didn't expect was that it was also considerably less than the bike that could have been said to have started the whole mega-powerful trend in the first place, the ZZR 1100. The old Z did itself proud at well over 138 bhp. But if the R1's output was a surprise, the Byrne's modest delivery was almost shocking. Less than 140 bhp for a bike that once claimed over 150. A clear deficit over the Hayabusa, whose 22 bhp advantage ended up at exactly almost 160 bhp at the back wheel. Thank you. You've only got to listen to the Suzuki screaming induction to know that nothing else at the moment really comes close. Fact that was confirmed by the traceover graphs. Having already run the R1 and the ZZR at the strip, we needed only dial in the Buser and the Byrne. Though of course the first thing to do is warm up the tyres in traditional fast bike style. And it's not just the Buser that can get it sideways on the power. And all this without even feathering the clutch. Considering how many stupid safety aids Byrne's encumbered with to prevent you having fun, it availed itself remarkably well. But in the end, it really was no match for the GSXR and the cunning stunts department. And try as it might, it was never going to match it for top speed either. 178 miles an hour. To just about 187 miles an hour. And here's the difference in real life.
Rob, this one's empty.
Real life, of course, is what it's all about here at MP. So what better way to test them than a flat-out blast all the way to the south of France?
Oh, already. Trip's over. We're going back home, boys. There's no petrol. So if I stop fucking it, and come on! Oh, fuck! Kunani, Rob! You know what I'm saying? It's like Kunani! Wicked!
The boys' brief was to take it easy in England, so of course we speeded the background up. Over in France, no such need for caution. And with the Byrne flat out for the first time, Buser showed its real-time advantage, sneaking past 12 miles an hour faster. again, flat out on the berg. Just watch the Buser go. The first petrol stop gave Ollie and Jimmy the chance to catch up. But with Jimmy's legendary nighttime vision worrying everybody else around him, we decided it'd be a better idea to retire gracefully and do the whole coast-to-coast kick in the morning. Did I say gracefully? Shakey seems to have adopted Jimmy's mantle of mechanical anarchist rather well, don't you think?
I couldn't pick it back up! I was like, stop!
It's a quick pickup.
One last wheelie before bedtime. Dawn in a peaceful French town.
Shakey, that's right. I want Shakey to ride the Punani. I want Frosty on the mothership.
Shakey always wants to ride
myself. I take the blue cat, you know what I'm saying? And like you can go on the biplane over there.
That thing still has propellers, man.
Let the madness begin. First thing the boys have got to do is sort out the longest wheelie champion. Shakes is still ahead, but Frosty's catching up pretty fast. Check this out. Pretty soon, however, it was into top speed mode for real. And we mean top speed. The R1's indicating 190 miles an hour. When the Buser flies past. 210 miles an hour on the clock is quite a sight, even if it is about 20 miles an hour optimistic. Finally, it's time for swapsies. And now that he's on the Buser, Shakey is obviously anticipating takeoff. Because he's wearing a parachute. Does he realize that the worst danger comes not at 200 miles an hour, but at standstill? That is, when Jimmy's behind you. On the move, Shakey proves that the Buser is faster than most things on one wheel. Establishes once and for all that the R1 tank range barely sees out the length of good stand-up wheelie. Never mind, the boys are well versed in this. When things get a little boring on long trips, you feel the need to stretch your legs. Need more water. Why not just stretch your face? to serious business. As the Buser piles on the MPH, everything else behind it disappears. This time, showing a monumental 250 miles an hour on the clock. Time flies when you're having fun. But even time's not as fast as the Hayabusa. Just 300 kilometers to go. That's about 1 hour 15 minutes on the GSXR, including a fuel stop, which you need after just 25 minutes at 3 miles a minute. Not to mention a little heat. And a bit of practice for the ZZR suspension.
Damn!
Another petrol station, another sacrifice. At last, Monzilio beckons. 730 miles, 1,000 plus kilometers, in about 6.5 hours, with 10, repeat 10, stops for fuel. That's got to be worth a little celebration wheelie, though it was to prove ultimately fatal for the ZZR.
BlackBird was the best.
Why?
For this trip.
It's the most comfortable, the best gearbox, the cruise nice, accelerating good.
And it does bollocks. Wicked stand-up wheelies.
The R1 does all that, and it's...
Yeah, it doesn't. To be fair, the R1 rips your head off when you get above 100 and whatever.
The Punani bike.
The Punani
number
bike
one.
Is
number one. The Punani good. Bike rules.
Yeah. Amazingly, though the boys were still raring to go after 3 hours sleep, the Red Baron, aka the ZZR, was feeling a little jaded. One down, three to go. Back on terrain we knew well, Shakey, Jimmy and Frosty we're going for the kind of stunt that all boys dream of. A three-up. Maybe synchronized wheeling should become a new Olympic sport. Having worked out that they were all pretty good at wheeling, it was time to sort out the roll-ons. out the distinct darkies all three bikes leave. You can literally see the rubber evaporating, even at 130 miles an hour in fifth. And when they got their counting sorts right, there's no doubt that they are one in the end. The R1's power to weight ratio also meant that the others didn't have much of a chance on the A roads either. Though the heavier bikes did look a lot more stable. Combat was shortly resumed, however. And on possibly the scariest road in the whole of the south of France. You couldn't imagine a worse place to match Jimmy and Frosty with a bird and abuser than the Le Luc to Le Garde road. Especially when you've got Shane up front on an R1. This road has claimed myself on a Blade, Frosty on a ZX9, Jimmy on an X-Up, and Hammer on a 600. So what chance did the boys have on 210kg, 160bhp bikes? Against the 175kg R1, none, quite frankly. Amazingly, apart from nearly ramming the village cafe on the last hairpin, they all survive. Jimmy explains his overshoot.
So I had my first ever test, you know, four
points. What?
First ever accident I had for Colin.
Yeah.
Right here where we're standing.
Was it? What did you do?
Came down there, and instead of like overshooting the corner like I did back there and pretending I'm going to a restaurant, what I did was, I went across there, there was a Renault 4 van coming up here. So I just thought, fuck it, why not? So I lobbed this X up underneath it. And I think you'd have liked it. Definitely your kind of thing.
Down from the village, the longer, faster, smoother bends are much more suited to the heavier weight, higher horsepower bikes, and for once they can almost live with the R1. Again, rather amazingly at these speeds, the only oncoming moment the boys had was with a fly. Day 3. Serious stuff. We were down to 2, having mullered the R1's tyre. Not that the other two were looking that much better. Actually, considering we were headed for the 10-day pass, this was no bad thing, because someone would have surely died trying to keep up with the Yamaha in a place where the runoffs consist of 1,000-metre ravines. Europe, there is no more testing road than the 70 kilometres from Monton to Tendu. Shakey gets in some practice while Rob gets wired up with a camera. Actually, this was to prove a rather unfair advantage. As first run up, Rob very nearly collides with the wall. Just check that suspension, Wallow. With slower but more neutral steering than the Buser, the Byrne has to rely much more on mid-corner speed. Unfortunately, that just means it decks out everywhere. With its linked braking system, neither can the Honda be backed in like the Suzuki. Now Shakey's really got the hang of sliding the abuser on the way in. And as you can see, even when the bird gets ahead for a couple of corners, the Buser's got it all covered. Leaving Rob to play catch up on exit yet again.
Fucking hell.
Are you scared of the dark? You should be. At 130 miles an hour. The other side of the village of Suspel, and if you thought sliding it in looked pretty fierce, you ain't seen nothing yet. Wait for it. The trip's first unadulterated pure power slide. As it happens, the first of hundreds. If you can have more fun than this, we don't know where, and we don't know how. I mean, these ain't exactly little moments. No siree. They're tire-smoking, GP500-style-y power slides. The boys decide once just ain't enough, and head down for another go. So how do you top that? You don't. At least not on the ZZR11, which finally threw in the towel halfway home. Luckily, it was fixable, which was just as well, as the truck and trailer blew up terminally.
Yeah. How do you think the engine got a little bit too warm, Rob? Rob? Any news?
Well, it's nearly fucking done. It's all together and it's running. Let's get one.
Okay. Three bikes, but barely one tire between them. The return journey was necessarily a lot more low-key. With an embargo of 120 miles an hour on all three bikes, and the steels of the Hayabusa's rear tire already showing through, it was a very, very restrained return journey. Of course, it even started raining.
Some stunt shine, know what I mean? Donuts, a few stobbies.
Not on a brand new tyre.
Not on a brand new tyre, all.
Stoppies you can do. Not stoppies really. Are alright for the motorcycle.
Not a new rear tyre, mate.
So every tyre does indeed have a silver lining. and I suppose if ours hadn't shown through so quickly, we may not have all made it back alive.
Do you think it's like good for London or not?
I was just thinking of your health, Jimmy. You know, I didn't want you riding it on the way back.
I'm still gonna have a go, my son. I think it's all right.
Better with stuff into suspenders as well, so you
get your ass out of here.